It's Fran at my bench with another rather interesting and slightly menacing item. I'm sure if you're watching this video or watching my channel that you have seen the classic 1983 film Wargames, which still remains among my top list of rewatchable films, and I actually revisited the film this week in sort of prepping for this video for this artifact. But one of the things about that film, fun fact, with the exception of a few outdoor scenes that are shot in that film, everything in that film is shot on sets that are built on a soundstage, including the very realistic and menacing looking Titan missile firing room that they have the critical opening scene to. And apparently the people who made that film, they built that set based on real photographs and government films about, you know, missile firing rooms that the government had published. So the level of realism was good enough, certainly, to scare the bejesus out of me in 1983. When I saw it, I always thought, oh, wow, they've got a real missile room to do that thing. Side note, in that scene, in fact, in a lot of the sets, like I said, all the like sets that they have, like in the NORAD and the Whopper War Room and all that stuff, it's all, they're all custom-built sets. And lots of those dial-light incandescent 7-segment displays like I had in the earlier video late last year, they have tons of those in War Games and all kinds of panels, and they have some in the missile firing room scene. But what I got here on my bench is the real deal. This is from the, I'm assuming from the early 80s, but when I get it open, hopefully I'll get some dates or something. But this is a real targeting display. Let's just go take a look at it. All right, this is the actual item. This is it's an LED display. This module is made to plug into a panel. It's got some, looks like Delrin or Teflon rails on the bottom. It's got conformal coated boards, a single connector on the back, one serial connector, no separate power connectors or anything, a couple of stops here, some wear. This was definitely in a panel and then removed. But yeah, it's the real deal. It has a label on the front here. Comes from the Space and Naval Warfare Systems Command. If there's a more sinister or scary name for anything, I've never heard about it. It's an indicator of intra-target data. It's got some serial number there, decoder group, yada yada yada. Instructions high up here. Manually guide the rear cable to the upper right as the unit is inserted in the enclosure. Don't forget to do that. It says property of U.S. Navy, but this was decommissioned. This is from a, you know, an extinct missile system, so it's declassified. This is the real deal. And I said, aside, it's got this door. Don't need that. Come out here. Is it? It's got a foam block that's it's a little sticky, but the boards are all removable. Go to a back plane. You can see the telltale back plane on the backboard there. So these boards are individually removable. Yes, there's a lot of pins in this. Let's see if I can coax one out here. Probably like a good 100 pins on the back of these boards. They're really in there. I'm just trying to use the... Oh, there we go. Whew. A little bit of coaxing. Oh, look at that bodge. Wow. Didn't expect that. All right. We're in. The back plane has the pins, and the board has the socket. All right. All conformal coated, as you'd expect. The whole thing's conformal coated. A lot of discoloration there from heat, so... So I would have thought this would be in, like, forced air cooling or something, you know, to keep it cool, but looks like this board got pretty hot. It's all 7400 series stuff. Yeah, 7400. Well, I hit this one right on the nose. What do we got here? Was that an 85? Looks like 85, so 79. So, yeah, this is definitely this is right in the middle of the Wargames era. Pretty confident that even though some of these chips are dated from 85, that the design for this goes back to the 70s, most likely. Stamps on the board there, inspection stamps. Some Texas Instruments. I always love seeing like a mil-spec board for an American missile system with chips made in Indonesia. Gotta love it. Taiwan. It's like, definitely, they probably cost thousands of dollars for this board to be made, and they're buying the cheapest chips they can get. Taiwan made, Indonesian made, Singapore. None of the chips made in the US. It's just going to the bottom of the barrel for a cost. All 7400 series stuff. Nothing spectacular. It's your, you know, very typical 70s era dual-sided board design, you know, no solder mask, it's just a bare FR4 board with the traces in a typical 70s fashion. You got one side, you got the traces going horizontally, and the other side, you got them running vertical. Really nice layout there, getting the traces down to the socket. You gotta love that. That is hand laid out. No computer-aided drafting. That is drawn lines on vellum at probably 2 or 4x scale, and then they, you know, shrink it down, make it optical, and laid out by hand. Yeah, you don't see traces like that anymore, that's for sure. I'm really surprised at this. This looks like a bodge right here. And it looks like they've got... these are like squidges of like epoxy there that holding this wire down. But then it was like they got the whole thing done and thought, oops, we left out that one. Left out that one pin. We'll have to put a bodge in there and put it all the way up there. Oops. Tax dollars at work. Whew. Like I said, this thing probably costs thousands of dollars in government money. This whole thing comes apart from the front, because I can see this back piece is all like basically one single piece clamshell screwed together through the middle, but in order to access it, you gotta take the front panel off. And there's four screws, Phillips head screws, to take that off, so... Yeah, this is really exciting. I was really thrilled to be able to get this. It's just, you know, every now and then you come across something that, you know, and this really wasn't even listed as like military surplus or anything. It's just, you know, you really, really have to look for the needles in the haystack sometimes, and this is one of those. You get to look at some real genuine war games missile indicator. And I did some research for this particular looking up the names and the numbers, and the company that made this, they specialized in doing guidance for missiles and radar tracking and such, so this would have, because this is listed as intra-target data, I imagine this would be for targeting for a missile system, indicating, bearing and heading, who knows. If you're military, if you know what this layout is, please give a... you know, something in the description say exactly what this would have indicated. But this is the front panel. Even though these boards, even though the logic boards inside are all conformal coded, this display board is not, which I find very surprising. You think that the display, especially with the drivers and such, that this would have been conformal coded too, or at least protected in some way from moisture or humidity or whatever. Conformal coding, I mean, there's you know, several different kinds of conformal coating. Actually, there's like lots of different kinds of conformal coating, but kind of runs the gamut from either like moisture barrier to, you know, chemical resistance. Some of them are heat transmissive and such. Some are silicone based, some are epoxy. Really, but the general idea is, you know, for something like this is usually for moisture control and to, you know, also to make it, you know, hermetically seal so that, you know, your oxygen and whatever doesn't get in to contacts or what. But yeah, no conformal coating. Looking for DICAs, obviously, you know, it's got some codes, assembly number, and interesting too, so even though these are 80s era chips, all these chips are ceramic wafer type kind, where it's not like a plastic injection molded. It's like two wafers of ceramic material that are kind of cemented together, got the die in the middle, sort of with an epoxy core, sort of the sandwich type method. Tried and true. Again, probably ceramic because of the mil-spec nature of this thing, but yeah. 1980 date codes. So again, that confirms my suspicion that this is from 1970s design, even though it's manufactured in the 80s. So these, 1, 2, 3, 4, so these are Fairchild 9368DC 7-segment decoder drivers, four of them. It's also a kind of a 70s era can style transistor up there. Yeah, pretty straightforward as far as the display itself goes. But people are going to say, oh, Fran, why don't you fire this up? I said, well, fire what up? It's there's nothing labeled. You know, you go to the back plug. It's not like, oh, there's a power connector. No, everything goes through this single socket, you know, power and serial data and everything. I'm going to go another level deeper. It's all solid wire. None of this braided wire garbage. Oh, yep. Solid Teflon wire. Whew. Doesn't feel like copper either. See how it's really got a lot of flex to it. It's some kind of alloy. Probably highly vibration resistant and all that crap. But wow. So you want to solder some connections. That's really hard to bend. Yep, that's some, that is some soldering back there, pads. It looks like it's got a laminated layer in there. That's pretty sophisticated. Looks like a three-layer board at least for that laminated board. So you want to fire this up and try and you know, work out the wiring scheme to power it and everything. Yeah, good luck. You just go through and trace that. It's the same thing on the back where the jack is. Yeah. Look in there. It's the back jack's like, yeah, sure. Go ahead and trace that out to the back plane. Go to the back plane and trace those and, yeah, maybe figure out where the plus rail is and the negative rail and all that. But is it worth it? No, because this thing is displaying, you know, probably encrypted serial data. Probably using the data encryption algorithm. You'll never break that. Ooh, oh, hang on. I'm going to yank another board out. With these holes in the boards, they probably had some kind of special tool that they used to pop these out without breaking them. Because there's these sets of holes which look like they would probably, you know, if you had like a tool that would go into these holes, it probably just pop it right out. if I had the right tool. Ah, coax it without breaking it. Oh, come on. It goes without saying that there's a hefty amount of insertion force needed. Man, I'm gonna I'm gonna break my screwdrivers. I'm trying to get this out. Oh man. I'm literally bending that screwdriver. I'm rocking it back and forth now. Just kind of pulling on it with the pliers, kind of sideways. I'll make it easy. Ah, oh, Oof. Damn. All right. Phew. Oh, yeah. Here we go. Yeah. Again, look at the, I don't know if it shows up on the camera, but man, it's got some severe discoloration to it. They were really running these things hot. 7400 logic. Singapore. Gotta love it. This unit, maybe this unit was serviced over time, because these are all decoded from 88. So we've gone from 79 to 88. And got some transistors here. They're Motorola 2N4237. I'm gonna look them up. Come on, focus. I can't really focus this close. Yeah. But these little ones here, these are labeled JAN, G-A-A-N. That's a Joint Army Navy 2N2222s. Pretty classic. Yep. Gotta love the little 1/8-watt carbon composite resistors in there. Is that a little tantalum duty? That might be tantalum. Yeah. They used to love to drop tantalum stuff in the 80s. See all the goo. They glued that down. 100 microfarad. Glued it good. I'm going to pull out this one because this has got some big-ass chips on it. So, let's see here. Oof. Oof. All right, tax dollars at work, government surplus for you. All right, that one came out a lot easier than the last one. All right. Oh yeah. Pay dirt. Oh yes. Look at that. Is that beautiful or what? Oh ho ho. Baby. That's where I wish I had a microscope. And see it there, under the loop. Yep, open die. It's about as close as I can get with my camera, yeah. But you can see it there, all the bond wires, wow. Wow. That's gorgeous. Wow. So I'm guessing that's an EEPROM, where you can erase it with some ultraviolet light, flash it, and I just noticed it's upside down. So as people in Australia would know, that causes the electrons to all fall out. We're into another 1985, Indonesia. Yep. 9322, some more Fairchild chips, so ITT chips, some Texas Instruments made in Taiwan, 74154 DC, again decode 85, so yeah, these boards are made at different times. Yep, got a little trimmer there, a multi-turn boards. Some more discrete transistors. Yep. But that would be the heart of it right here. So, I'm not going to speculate. I don't really have any experience on exactly how a military decoder would work. But obviously, all discrete. Man, that is just... it was really gorgeous. That's the beauty shot right there. That's definitely the beauty shot. Wow. Yeah. Woof. Gotta love it. Alright. Well, that's it for this one. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this kind of teardown. I am going to put it back together before I put it back. But I want to keep this out a little while. I'm going to take a closer look at it with my loop. But some interesting factoids about that movie Wargames. And like I said before, I was always impressed with the sets, because all of those sets, including the interiors, like in the apartments and the high school and all that, those were all just sets. So I mean, the lighting and cinematography and set design on that film was so good that it really makes it still riveting and believable even today. And I always thought that the people that actually made those sets, like in the missile launch room and also in the big war room and the NORAD room, I thought that they must have had a lot of fun designing and building all those panels and sets, because I think at the time that film was made, that war room scene comprised more video monitors and film projectors synchronized that had ever been done in a movie before, because those big displays, I think big 35 millimeter rear projection displays for those big panels, and all those projectors were synchronized with the camera that was filming the sets, so it all had to be coordinated, and all the video monitors, there were dozens of them, they all had to be synchronized with the camera, because this was on film, because in the pre-CGI days, this was a very ambitious sort of set to build. They utilized that big war room set as much as possible by building all these other sets for other scenes that had that overlooked the war room, just so that they could use the money they put in it. Which seems like a great cost-cutting feature, except you come to realize that they had to run that set every time it was in the background, which meant that every time that it was just a little bit of it in the background, they had to run all of those projectors, and they had to have extras running around pretending they were pushing panels and stuff all in the background just to make it realistic. So really, really hats off to that. And, you know, people today, probably not many of them realize that that scenario that occurred in War Games, it actually happened. We were within 2 minutes, so they say, within 2 minutes of global thermonuclear war in 1995, because of something that has become known as the Norwegian missile incident. You can look it up. But apparently the Russians were at high alert, and their atomic football was like open, and I think Boris Yeltsin had his finger on the actual button, ready to blow the whole world to kingdom come, and it got like very close, just because some little scientific sounding rocket fired in Norway was misconstrued as an American sub-launched MIRVed ICBM. man, it's they took a lot of liberties in War Games, in the movie War Games, but some of them are pretty glaring. Like in that opening scene with the Titan II missile firing room, they have shots of a scale model that they built of a Titan II in the silo, and as they're getting ready to enable the missiles, they have shots of the missile being fueled up and like it's getting full of cryogenic mist and everything, because they're loading it with the oxidizer and liquid and whatever to fire it up, and it's all like steaming cryogenically. Even though the Titan II didn't use liquid oxygen and it didn't, and they didn't fuel the rocket readying it to fire, the Titan II was always fueled in the silos. That's what made them, you know, ready to launch within seconds. They used hypergolic propellants. It was dimethylhydrazine and nitrogen tetroxide for the Titan II, which, you know, not only didn't they steam, but they were, you know, they were always ready to go. But of course, having a fully pressurized hypergolic intercontinental ballistic missile in a silo is an extremely dangerous condition. And the Titans, even before the earlier Atlas were also put into silos, they were RP-1 and LOX, and even those tended to blow up in the silos. And even the Titan IIs with the hypergolic fuel, they would occasionally explode or leak. People would occasionally get killed or severely injured or have to be evacuated because of problems with that. I'm glad we don't do that anymore, although they did end up replacing the Titan II fleet with, Peacemaker missiles, a solid rocket fuels. But, man, that whole thing. Another interesting tidbit about the movie Contrary to what people would think or believe, the electronic voice of Joshua, the computer, was not digital at all, and it wasn't computer generated. It was actually the actor John Wood, who played Stephen Falcon. The producers, they had him read Joshua's dialogue in an atypical order. I think they reversed the order of all the words, and they had him read very slowly, so that he read his lines very slowly, so that they could speed up the tape, and then they spliced it up and rearranged the words into the order so it would sound really mechanical. They took his sped up voice and they put it through a vocoder so they could process it and, you know, sort of process the audio through analog vocoder. So it's completely analog, and it's actually John Wood's voice doing Joshua. But yeah, lots of liberties you can talk about. I could talk about war games all live long day. But anyway, that's it for this one. Honestly, I'm putting it to an end now. It's gotten too long. Couldn't resist ranting about one of my favorite rewatchable films, War Games. Like I said, I just watched it the other day. I still enjoy watching it. It's a good compliment to, there's another similar 80s film, not as well made, not as scientifically accurate, but equally fun, is the Manhattan Project, although completely unrealistic. You know, in the Manhattan Project, if the kid really would have, like, melted, like, half a kilogram of plutonium in an aquarium sitting over it, and he would have had a lethal dose of gamma rays in no time. He certainly would have, like, you know, died of radiation sickness. And anybody who was near that half-assed bomb that he built for more than, you know, a few minutes probably would have gotten radiation sickness too. But anyway, I'll digress about that movie. But anyway, thanks for watching. I'm Fran. I'll be back here in the lab real soon with something else. And thanks to everyone on the Patreon who made this video possible. Thank you, thank you, thank you. If you enjoyed this video or any video I make, then consider becoming a patron. Just follow the link in the description. It's how we do this Fran Lab thing. It's how we keep the lights on, keep it going. So thank you to everyone on Patreon. Thank you. I'll be back here at the bench real soon with something else interesting. Something else interesting. And maybe grammatically or corrector. Real soon. Okay. Bye! Work. In the lab. Go berserk. In my lab. It's where I work. Yeah.